Today's qualifying from Norwalk, Ohio will be dramatic and tension-filled. There are 21 funny cars here, vying for the 16 spots. The first two sessions were rained out. There are only two sessions left to make it into the show. And there is even more pressure on the 25 Pro Stock cars here. And within their two sessions of qualifying today, the eight contenders in the K&N Horsepower Challenge will be racing for $50,000 as well as qualifying. Tension, who can handle it, and who will fold?
Hi, I'm Paul Page with Mike Dunn, and we are in the staging lanes, the middle of the action here at Norwalk, Ohio, where yesterday it rained, it poured, it washed out two sessions of qualifying. And as a result, the tension is on, especially on Pro Stock, because Pro Stock today has the K&N Horsepower Challenge. And that is worth $50,000 in prizes. But the tension is not just there.
Well, I guarantee it's the whole facility, all the classes right now with the rain from yesterday, especially the K&N Challenge. I guarantee you the drivers, crew chiefs, they didn't get much sleep last night, but the good news is K&N drivers are going to get one qualifying session today before they go into eliminations, and the track looks perfect right now.
And the time for talking is over. Let's go. Series from Norwalk, Ohio, where today we're qualifying in Pro Stock Motorcycle, Funny Car and Top Fuel, and the K&N Challenge. Hi, I'm Paul Page with Mike Dunn, Gary Gerald, and Dave Reif. Top Fuel sits on the line right now. Luigi Novelli and Ike Meyer. Neither one gets down the track. And right there, Mike, is the pressure that we are talking about. You've got to get down this track. You've got to get a time. They have one session left. The conditions here, though, are pretty good.
Absolutely, with only two sessions. The good news is they put some new asphalt down recently here. A lot of teams were a little bit skeptical of it, but we went out and looked at it. It is absolutely perfect. The new asphalt from 600 feet to the finish line is a smooth and good contact area. We saw some great numbers out of Pro Mod and Pro Stock.
We're on Top Fuel right now. Coming up will be Funny Car. And one man is the focus there. Last weekend at Bristol, Funny Car driver Robert Height, the winningest Funny Car driver since his debut in 2005, set his first ever national record, 316 miles an hour, while going on to win the event and take home his fourth Wally this year.
When you sense a 316 mile an hour run, you don't really know it by how it's pulling. More than anything, it's how the sound. It's revved up, the RPMs are up, the pistons are in it, music to my ears, nothing better.
With Jimmy Prock and his AAA racing team by his side, can anyone stop Robert Height in his pursuit for his second world championship?
Riding the momentum of a most impressive performance in the victory at Bristol a week ago, Robert Height and his team today facing a different kind of pressure because of the rain. Only two qualifying sessions to come today, 21 cars vying for 16 spots. Robert, how critical will focus and performance be on this busy day?
It's huge, Gary. I'm more nervous on a day like this than if the track was 130 degrees, because my crew chief could just slow the clutch down and get it down there. But when the conditions are like they are today, it's track is tight, and you've got to slip that tire. If it doesn't, it's going to shake, and it may shake anyway. And as a driver, you've got to either commit to pedaling it or commit to hoping it goes through there. And like Mike Dunn will tell you, if you commit the wrong way, you're too late. So it's very nerve-wracking. You're going to see some great runs today, but it's go time. We've got to really focus and pay attention. That's why the crew chiefs make the big bucks.
We're looking forward to it. Wish you well.
Thank you.
You bet we are. Here comes the Greek, Chris Karamassinis and Pat Dakin. What a story the Greek was last week. Mike, here's the temperature conditions right now.
That's right. We talked about the track conditions, but the air is very good right now. As you heard Robert Height talk about, it makes the track very tight with that cloud cover. So basically, it can be a little bit of a crapshoot here trying to get down the track, especially with only two sessions.
148 years of combined experience on the line between Karamassinis and Dakin. Whoa, big fire over there for Dakin. Karamassini's had his problem too. Still burning on Dakin's car. There are 17 top fuel cars here. So somebody will go home, and if he's dropping stuff on the track and it stays there, neither one is run is going to count. That's the word from the officials now.
Now remember, all the teams get one oil down credit. In other words, they can oil down the racetrack one time. Pat Dakin already done it to more than once. Probably, if you take a look at it, I think the Greek crossed the center line. That might be why his run. Yep, his run's disqualified because he crossed the center line. Pat Dakin put oil on the racetrack, so both of those runs will be disallowed, and they'll have one more shot in the final session to try to get into the show.
That's the tension we're talking about.
See the Greek there, the cylinder out, and helped push the car over towards the center line. He's pushing head gaskets out. Might have got it to some point and just drifted over right there across that center line and disqualified the run. One more look at it. You see, once that thing got out of the groove, it just wanted to drive that car over. The Greek lifted before it crossed the center line, but his momentum just carried it over.
A little more on the Greek. Remember how caustic he was in the interview with Gary Gerald after his round win? Well, since his round win in 1990 at Reading, these are the things that have happened that he's done, the world's done.
21 seasons, 463 national events, a span of 4 U.S. presidents, and we had 41 different top fuel winners and 7 champions in that time, and all of 15 of John Force's wins came in that period between his round wins.
It was so popular, even Antron Brown interviewed him at Bristol last week. Here comes David Grubnick and Bob Vandergrift.
Well, we talked about the track conditions. Remember, the new asphalt surface, I mean, it is green. There's not a whole lot of rubber on it. The only real cars that can put rubber are the fuel cars. They spin the tires, even on a run where they don't smoke them. It's a controlled spin from start to finish. So it's going to help to get more rubber on there. But as I said, the surface is very, very good. They should be able to take a little bit out of it and get down that track and make a decent run.
Grubnick gets it down with a 395. Vandergrift wisely puts a number up, a 576 at 118 miles an hour. So there's a new standard to look at in top fuel. Dave Reif, well, Dave's thinking about pro stock.
Well, Paul, as we look forward to the K&N Horsepower Challenge, I can tell you the top 7 guys earned their way in based on performance. And had Erica Anders been racing at the end of last year, her qualifying performance may have got her in. But it is the fan vote that gives you an opportunity today to race for $50,000. Your second start, what does that opportunity mean?
Oh, it means the world to me. What an honor. I mean, we got to thank K&N for putting the race on. It's such a fun deal for all the pro stock drivers out here. Huge thanks to the fans, friends, and family back at home voting. I know the social networking thing really helped. And everybody's email list, so I really appreciate you guys' votes, and I'm going to do my best to do a good job. We got a very competitive race car, so I'm looking forward to it.
She races Jason Lyon, trying to become only the second woman ever to win an NHRA specialty race. The other one, Shelley Anderson, now Shelley Payne. She did it in top fuel.
It would be huge if Erica can do that. Look at this, up at the edge of the clouds. It's the Goodyear Airship. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Everything we've learned making tires for the proving grounds of the NHRA inspires what we roll into yours. Goodyear, more driven.
There she is. I always love the blimp shots. Can really show the actual lead changes going down the racetrack when they're running as fast as they are. Sometimes it's tough to catch it on our normal camera shots.
I always love the blimp, but I just would love to be able to ride in it sometime. Terry McMillan is up on the line now, and Sean Langdon.
These are two teams that have really, I think, improved quite a bit this year. John Stewart, crew chief for Sean Langdon, is getting that car running some mid-380 lap times. And we saw Terry McMillan with his crew chief, Richard Hartman. They're running in the high 380 range on a consistent basis.
Now we'll see some numbers. How about McMillan with a 391, a 385 for Langdon. Langdon, with that, even though it's only 8 cars gone down the track so far, now Sean Langdon stands one, McMillan second.
I think both teams will be very happy with these runs. They did exactly what they wanted to do, that mid-380 run by Sean Langdon. Richard Hartman probably took just a little bit out of the car just to make sure it went down the track. Yeah, Richard, he likes that run. 391, great job.
Well, next pair getting ready to come down the track is Brandon Bernstein. He was number one qualifier a week ago, and Morgan Lucas. Speaking of a week ago, Father's Day, and Larry Dixon did it again. He won on Father's Day. It was his first win of the year. Has he got it figured out now? He'll be coming up. ESPN's presentation of the Summit Racing Equipment NHRA Nationals is brought to you by Full Throttle. Grab a Full Throttle energy drink and feel the energy at work. Summit Racing Equipment, the world's speed shop, and Castrol GTX High Mileage. Help extend the life of your engine. Well, a beautiful look down the lake, not all that far from here in Norwalk, Ohio. This is a gorgeous area to come to, especially in the summer. It's full of all kinds of things to do. The Summit Racing Equipment Nationals, that's what we're doing right now from Norwalk, Ohio, and Brandon Bernstein. He has 14 poles now with his one a week ago in Top Fuel. Just like my buddy sitting next to me, Mike Dunn, he had 14 in his career.
Well, Brandon Bernstein hasn't been doing it as long as I did it, though. But I'll tell you what, they've been doing a very good job in qualifying. They're starting to get together on race day, making some good runs. It's just a matter of time before they'll get that win. Morgan Lucas, on the other hand, that's Sean Langan's teammate. He's just trying to get down, working on that consistency to get that win. Look at that.
That was pretty. Bernstein, 385, 386 for Lucas. We have a new number one. It's Brandon Bernstein as he displaces Sean Langdon. Morgan Lucas goes into third.
The key here, too, is the top speeds that these cars are running. Not only are they running good 8-mile speed, 275, 278 miles per hour at the eighth mile, but that top speed on that new surface, 313, 315, that's very good for a green racetrack.
This is a look at McMillan's car. Of course, after the run, I'm assuming none of that got on the track, but that's not pretty.
No, a lot of oil there, but that containment system underneath that engine, it looks like it contained any from getting on the racetrack, so that as a result of that, the run counts.
And that's the trick of the rule. You can leak, it just can't get on the track. Back to the starting line. Tony Schumacher, the U.S. Army car, and Doug Coletta, you saw his teammate, Dave Grubnick, go down the track a little bit earlier. Grubnick currently sits in fifth. We've got a nice onboard camera for you. Schumacher, still winless in 2011. That's just hard to believe.
And he's still optimistic, though. You know, he never gets down. He knows he does have a good race car. And he's been doing this long enough to know that, you know, little things can happen here and there. As long as you stay focused and don't try to make something happen, just keep with the game plan. You do have a good race car. He's a good driver. Eventually, it all comes together, and the wins start coming.
Doug Coletta, well, they've got Mac Tools back on board once again. Good for them. Been a while for Doug. Last 3 years here, he's lost in first round.
The key here, the track conditions look very good, but you really want to focus and make that perfect run down the middle of the racetrack, try to keep it in that good rubber.
Schumacher, 384, Coletta, 389, another new number one, and this time it's Tony Schumacher. Coletta goes into fifth.
I tell you, they've just done a great job. They always do a great job here at Norwalk. Bill Bader and that family have always give the fans everything, every opportunity they can. They have no problem spending some money to make everything perfect. And tell you what, they've done a perfect job because everything in this first session has been fantastic up to this point.
And our next pair on the right lane there, that is Spencer Massey. Antron Brown is over on the left. I want to show you something. This is McMillan. He came around to the top end, popping, sputtering. Gary Gerald, what was going on?
Well, when Terry got out of the cockpit, Paul, he said he thought he'd thrown the rods out. Well, then the crew got here, and they looked, and they turned the motor over and said, no, that is not the case. But then there was a little bit of oil that dropped down underneath that power plant, and they determined that apparently something broke at the front of the engine. They were headed back to the pits to try to determine exactly what.
But, Gary, that oil dropped after he was off the track, so he's cool on the run itself.
Yes, there were no cleanup on the track, so no oil on the track that we were aware of.
Thank you, my friend.
Well, it looks like it might have possibly burned a couple pistons because we saw smoke coming out of the overflow tank and the oil out of the front. When that happens, it builds pressure up and sometimes pushes out that front gasket. That's where the oil comes from.
Remember Antron Brown last week in the final round? Parachute popped out. ended up the runner-up. Ambrose in trouble. Let's see where Spencer takes it. 388, 315 miles an hour. That'll put him in fifth, but Antoine Brown will just have one more session to go to get out of the bottom half of the field.
A little bit of a surprise from Antoine as we go on board with him. We haven't seen much tire smoke early in the run, and it might have been a condition there where it we'd have to look at it again, but maybe it went out there and just was a little bit too tight and went into tire shake. Watch the rear tire. Boy, really hiked the front end up good. That means it was hooked. Yep, you saw the tire shake, and as soon as it started spinning the tires, it went up in tire smoke. A lot of times the fix for that is you got to run the car harder and faster early to keep that from happening.
Now back in the staging lanes, Robert Height and his crew getting ready. Remember, he set a new national record just a week ago, and he has been very formidable this year. The team has been formidable. John Force has not yet won this year. Don't forget, tomorrow it's the Summit Racing Equipment Nationals. Finals are on the air at 8 o'clock. One of the questions we will answer is, can one of those guys on the line right now, Larry Dixon, coming off his first win of the season, go to another? And yeah, people get to go down and stand in between those Nitro cars, including Curly Muldowney. Breaks some friends down there and says, what do you think of the noise, the smell down here? Well, we've been talking about the K&N Horsepower Challenge, and Dave Reef has more.
Alan Johnson, one of only two drivers to win the K&N Challenge. Your big deposit slip came back in 2008, AJ, when you used a perfect light in the final. Is this race that close, that competitive, that you got to push the tree as well as the performance of the car?
You know, you're racing against the best of the best out here in pro stock, and on a typical Sunday, you got to be 20 or better to win a race. You get in this thing, you're against those guys that win a lot of races, so answer your question, hell yes.
Going up against one of those rookies, Shane Gray, coming up in just a bit.
Just yes. Hey, Stat Guy, you're watching Dixon.
That's right, Larry. Dixon became our fifth different Top Fuel race winner this season. Last year, it took all 23 events to get five different winners. Remember, Antron won the finals at the end of the season. Maybe there's a little bit more parity in Top Fuel this year.
Well, just the fact that Larry Dixon won 12 races last year, and it took him this long to get his first win, and it had to happen on Father's Day when he never loses.
Well, he had that in his pocket, though.
Yeah, pretty much. It's almost like nobody should show up, right?
I get to Father's Day, I'm it. Don't worry about it. I'm not worried.
Okay. Well, we got the two Alan Abbey teammates. Final pair out. Remember, it's based on point standing, so it's your number one, number two in the points for your first session here. And let's see what they can do on this racetrack. Oh.
Wow.
379-318.
You heard the radio call. 379-318. Nothing back from Dell, though. 416 for Larry Dixon.
Boy, you talk about being aggressive. Both drivers, 839 and 835 and 60 foot. That's an outstanding time for a Top Fuel dragster. Larry did a fantastic job of catching it and backpedaling that race car to run that 416. I mean, hats off to him for driving, but how about that 379 by Dell?
This is Terry McMillan's pit. They pulled the blower off. They're going to try to find out exactly why all that oil was all over what looked to be only the front of the engine, Mike.
Yeah, like I said, probably looked, had some piston damage in there. Might have pushed off that manifold gasket towards the front when that pressure came out.
Well, with the first of two sessions of Top Fuel now complete, here are the standings. You just saw Dell Worsham go number one, followed by Tony Schumacher. Brandon Bernstein still looking quick. Terry McMillan rounds out the top eight.
With 17 cars here, three of them had problems, two of them were disqualified, one couldn't start, and as a result, you only see 14 down there with Luigi in that 14th spot with an 8-11 laps time.
You know what that means. Tension, no mistakes, trying to get in. The Greek, Pat Dakin, Scott Palmer, one of those three is going home. And coming up, the K&N Horsepower Challenge. Erica Enders has her second start. When she comes up, she will face Jason Line. He may be a pro stock champion, but he's never won the challenge title.
Where winners are celebrated, champions are crowned, and legends are born. home of the biggest events in motorsports, ESPN and ABC.
Oh, it's chest thundering. It's awesome.
It sends all your sinuses into like a panic attack.
It hits your chest and it makes you go backwards, man. Explosion.
When you're watching them warm up, you're just feeling your chest thumping like that, and you know they're just about to like hit the throttle. And so you're braced, you got your feet wide, and you're just waiting. And then when they hit it, you jump, whether you know it's coming or not. It's awesome.
The fans love it. They take that shock of sound and they jump and then they run across the way, find another engine firing up.
Well, here's a guy that knows all about speed, all about power. Definitely speed. New national record last week. Conditions are pretty good here today. Can we see a bigger performance out of him in qualifying? He's coming up. Funny car on the line. Dale Creasy Jr. and that man, Daniel Wilkerson. He's got his bachelor degree from the University of Illinois. He could be an accountant if he's not sitting behind the wheel. Whoa, 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 whoa. Now, Peanut going all over the place. Caught it in time. That's good. Tim Wilkerson talking it over on the performance of Daniel. He runs a 6:21. 5:57 is the run for Dale Creasy Jr. And remember, there are plenty of funny cars here. So competition to get into the field is tight. John Capps. Yep, that's Ron Capps' brother. And Brian Thiel are up on the line now. Remember, Brian had a huge fire at Bristol on Friday and then DNQ'd on Saturday. Well, there is John Capps, brother of Ron, and earlier this year, Mike Dunn got to catch up with both of them. It's our all access.
Ron Capps, John Capps. First of all, which one's older? Ron. Now, when we were kids, we all raced everything. We were telling the story about how I had a little wagon with a parachute on and stuff, and you guys, same thing, or?
Yeah, it was bicycles, wagons, whatever we could get our hands on, and, he was just talking. Back then, he was like a guinea pig. We would get a little wagon. I think they're called moon wagons.
Moon wagon.
It had the little wheelie bar on the back.
Oh, really?
And, you'd have fun with it doing wheelies and push each other around. Well, then we started coming up with ideas to tie it behind a bicycle and get going really fast, and we'd stick John in there. He was like Mikey on the live cereal commercials. Like, we'll put John in there.
I used to have to go get the mail. So we're hanging out in our underwear, just being kids, eating cereal all day, watching cartoons. And I get like a couple steps out. Don't close the door on me. Oh yeah, I got you. So a couple steps more, I look back and he's still on the couch. Next thing you know, I sprint down there, put my hand in the mailbox. Boom, doors closed, looking out the window laughing at me. And our neighbors, nice little lady, was like, what's the matter, you get locked out again?
Now that's just mean. I would never have done that to my brother.
Why do little boys always want to hang around in their underwear?
Yeah. Ron Capps back in the staging lane while his brother is on the line. And we'll go side by side with Brian Thiel in their first of two passes down the track. So, once again, we can't say it enough. It is very important to get down this track and get a good run in right away. That's getting one in here will be Thiel, 4:25. You see a flash of fire there. John doesn't get down the track at all.
That's unusual for Paul Smith, the crew chief there. His cars usually go down the track from A to B pretty consistently. They may not run the big number, but they usually go down the racetrack. But we take a look at Brian Thiel. Nice run early. Had some decent numbers and about 252 miles per hour at the eighth mile. Doubles that up with a 4:25 lap time, but looks like you probably got a little bit of engine damage at the finish line.
Well, that was pretty uneventful considering this a week ago for Brian Thiel. He lit it up big time.
Yeah, this was just a lot of smoke today, but back then there was a lot of fire, and it got plenty warm for him as he was trying to get that thing stopped at that particular event.
Back in the pits, Dave Reif is continuing to watch Terry McMillan.
Yeah, I talked to his crew chief, Richard Hartman, found out about why the oil was on the front of the car, not down on the racetrack. Basically, the situation was as the car approached the 1,000-foot mark, it was running a little bit too lean. This is the head gasket that separates the cylinder head from the block, and when a car goes lean, temperatures go way, way high, and something's got to give, and something finally did right next to the number one cylinder here. That's what allowed all that oil to escape. The good news, as I mentioned, though, that oil stayed above the racetrack. Terry McMillan has the number 8 qualifying spot despite that charred head gasket.
See, it was very close to getting to that number 3 cylinder. Had it crossfire right there at that point across, then it would have backfired. The supercharger could have done a lot more damage.
Back at the line, there's Bob Bodie. Best race on the tour this season was back in Houston. And Melanie Troxell racing them both Pro Mod and Funny Car again this weekend. A little story there we'll catch up on as well. Melanie doesn't get it off the line. Bob Bodie, 420, 291 miles an hour, puts him number one.
And for Melanie Troxell, another double-duty weekend in Pro Mod as well as Funny Car. She, of course, drives for Roger Burgess, who had a very eventful race the last time out when we were in Bristol. He repossessed the car that Melanie Troxell was driving. Melanie repossessed the car that Leah Pruitt-LeDuc was driving. She's got the weekend off, but both are in action here. And if you want to know what I'm talking about, all you got to do is check out our shows. July the 3rd starting at 2 o'clock, a full hour of Pro Mod for both Bristol and here in Norwalk.
Now, Roger was in just a horrendous crash at Bristol. We'll be able to update you on that as well. But let's pay attention to the line. Funny Car qualifying. One of two sessions, Paul Lee and Tony Pedregon. Nice. 419 for Tony, a 418 for Paul Lee. I think Jim Dunn should be happy with that. That puts Paul Lee number one. We have now 9 cars in the field.
2 side-by-side runs right down the racetrack. I think both crew chiefs would be happy with that because basically they just went up there and said, let's get it down the racetrack and get a decent run.
Well, the next pair will be Jim Head and Tim Wilkerson. We were talking about the crash in Pro Mod last week at Bristol. Look at this thing, Mike.
Watch the left side of your screen. That's Roger Burgess. Brand new race car. He gets it out of the groove towards the center a little bit, and that thing rotates around. Throttle snaps when it gets out of the throttle. And hard contact into that left side wall. One of the hardest hits I've seen in quite some time. But luckily, Roger was able to pretty much walk away from that wreck.
And with that car not being available, look at that. It brushes through the parachutes. With it not being available, well, that meant that they had to switch cars. It's time for our Castrol GTX High Mileage One to Watch. Tim Wilkerson.
Well, and he drives and tunes his Funny Car. He's only got 4 wins this season, but he's really starting to turn around. He's your defending event champion when he defeated John Force in the final. And his average qualifying position over the last 3 races has been getting much better. It's about a 4.7, so I like his chances this weekend.
Yeah, seems to have a great car in qualifying. Racing, not so much. Here we go. Oh, look at him pull out there. Oh! 416 for Tim Wilkerson, 419 for Jim Head. Tim Wilkerson now goes number one. Of course, remember, we're seeing the number one changes to some degree because this is the first of 2 sessions. Not unusual in the first session to see number one change a lot. John Force, defending and 15-time Funny Car champion. Trying to get it all focused up. He needs to. He hasn't won this season. The NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series back in the staging lanes at the Summit Racing Equipment Nationals. That's Cruz Pedregon. He has the low ET of the season so far. His 4.01 with a 5 at Pomona. He qualifies very well. On the line, Ron Capps and Johnny Gray. Capps was the first victim of Robert Height last week at Bristol. Johnny Gray had lane choice in his first round, made a good run, taken out by Jeff Aren though. comes away with a 409, 299 miles an hour, and we have another number one.
What's that? 09, 299.
I tell you, the general, Tim Richards, Ron Capps Cruz, he's starting to really get a handle on that Napa car. You see, as you said, Ron was having to do a little bit of driving. He wanted to drift over towards the center line at the finish, but Ron reeled it back in. No big deal. Ron's done this enough times, but a very nice pass out of that team.
Seems that there has been steady improvement since Tim and Kim have come back. Bob Tasca and John Force are up now. There is Tasca. And we have more for you on the K&N Horsepower Challenge. Here's Dave Reif.
Well, Greg, you've kind of made this K&N Horsepower Challenge your own little personal playground, winning it three times, including last year with a pair of hole shot victories, one over Mike Edwards in the final. Some of your best days have happened here, especially when you double up like you did a year ago.
Yeah, that was awesome. Absolutely awesome. We came into that event really with no confidence at all, and things just fell into place. Somebody was watching over us and had a fantastic day. Really kick-started our season towards that fourth championship. So I always love racing the K&N Challenge, and I certainly looking forward to this year.
How's the confidence today?
It's good.
That smile pretty much is going to say it all.
Yeah, he looks like he got something going there. Bob Tasca was on the pole at Bristol a week ago. He lost in round two, Cruz. John Force, well, his crew chiefs hold the track ET record here, a 4.03 with two.
They've been having trouble getting out of the first round. You know, Cruz Petragrande was able to beat them in that first round matchup. One of the few times that Cruz didn't qualify in the top half, they were your number 8 and 9 qualifier. So Cruz didn't have lane choice, but was able to take out John with a very good run.
Nice pass, a 4.14 for Tasca, but look at the 4.09 for John Force. He moves up to number two behind Caps. Tasca is now number three.
Take a look at two very good running Fords. Even though John has not been able to get out of the first round recently, he still has been making some very good runs. And that 4.09 with a 7, great job. You take a look at Bob Tasca Sr. watching them pass by his son, Bob Tasca the third, and he says, "Hey, go, man, go! Yeah!" We love that enthusiasm. It runs in the family.
Well, last night they made the announcement on the 2011 ESPY Best Driver nominations. Greg Anderson and John Force represent the NHRA. Don't worry about those other guys. What you got to do is get online right now, ESPN.com/ESPYs, and vote. Vote now, vote often, vote every chance you get. Well, the next pair coming up on the line will be Jeff Arendt and Matt Hagan. But let's send you up to the top end and Gary.
Ron Capps by a couple of thou, quicker than John Force for that number one spot. Still got a couple of more guys to sweat it out. We were talking this weekend about finding a rapport, a comfort zone with Tim Richards, the old pro back with your team. How's that coming along?
Really good. It's, you and I talked about it. It's that veteran type of crew chief. The guy, he rolls up there. There's nothing fancy. He's not profiling, trying to get on TV. He rolls you up there. He sends you up, and it was like having an ace around. It's that type of mentality where you don't even wait for a compliment. If you ever get a compliment from a guy like that, it's huge. But when they don't say anything to you, it's a compliment. And the fact that they tell you they don't have to worry about you as a driver and they concentrate on the tune-up is great. So Napa team, great job. Oakley, a Dodge, it's nice to get back in the swing and go down the track. It rattled the tires. As Goodyears were rattling, I thought it'd come loose, and it hooked up and took off, and we'll see if it stands.
All right, thanks.
Last time he sat on the pole, Denver, 2009. Hagan and Jeff Arendt. Arendt doesn't get down. That left lane's been hard on a lot of people. Hagan runs a 4.10 with a 6, 304 miles an hour. That is good enough for third. And now we have 16 qualifiers. ESPN's Sunday Night Baseball continues at 8 o'clock as the Cleveland Indians head to San Francisco for a matchup against the Giants. Giants host first-place Indians, first time since 2005. And then on Monday Night Baseball at 7 o'clock, the Cincinnati Reds take on the Tampa Bay Rays. Both games are a part of the ALNL Showdown presented by State Farm. Well, here comes Cruz Pedregon and Robert Height. The field now has 16 cars. Ron Katz is number one. His brother is number 16 on the bump with an 860. So he's probably going out. Dave Reed?
Well, Paul, as I stand in the staging lanes, funny car down to just two pair, and that means the butterfly's got to start going up for this guy, Roger Brogdon. It's his second K&N challenge coming up. You've got the benefit right now of going from the number one spot in qualifying. How much confidence does that give you against a guy like Mike Edwards?
We'll take everything we can against Mike. He's a very tough competitor, and we've raced very hard against each other, but we did make a really good run right then. The only thing I wish a little bit more if I had lane choice, but Jason went 58 in the right lane, so it ain't too bad.
Yeah, looking forward to this $50,000 winner take all, getting ready to start in just a couple of pair.
Yeah, somebody's going to be a lot richer at the end of the day, even richer still if they double up and win today and tomorrow.
On the line right now, we got two very powerful cars that have been running some big numbers this weekend. This should give the track a pretty good test.
Cruz gets out of it. Robert runs a 4.06 with a 5.306 miles an hour and takes Ron Capps off of number one. Daniel Wilkerson is now on the bump with a 6.21.
Tell you what, Ron, Robert Height, Jimmy Progman just doing a fantastic job. They're getting a handle on that left-hand lane, though. We've seen some cars, both Top Fuel and Funny Car, in that shake zone have some problems. It looks like it's very critical at getting down there. As you take a look from above, it's just a little bit trickier in that left-hand lane than the right lane right now.
Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Everything we've learned making tires for the proving grounds of the NHRA inspires what we roll into yours. Goodyear, more driven. You know, I think this guy, Greg Anderson, he just relishes pressure like this. He does well under it. Defending challenge champion, won 100K last year because he also won the race. The three-time race winner here on the line. Final pair, Funny Car, Mike Neff, and Jack Beckman. Yeah, and still burning a little bit there. 4.11 for Neff. That's going to put him fifth. Beckman's going to go ninth with a 4.18.
Watch Jack Beckman. Jack Beckman had a much better run than Mike Neff, and you're going to look at the early numbers. By the 330-foot mark, which is the first timing block you're going to see coming new right there, 300's quicker. This car was charging. The left front wheel was a little bit light. You see the nose drop. That's a normal deal, but boy, then just the backfire off of the supercharger and then just lit it up underneath that Valvoline body. And Jack Beckman knew he had to get out of the throttle at that point, but take a look from the blimp. Watch Jackson start just pulling away before that thing let go. Just nosed over just a little bit. Mike Neff makes a nice run, that 4.11, but Jack Beckman was on a very good run.
Well, there's Fast Jack. Obviously, he's okay. Not happy, but okay. Here are the standings. Robert Height, Ron Capps, John Force, top three. Paul Lee rounds out the top eight.
Look at the bottom eight. You got the Jack Beckman in that number nine spot with a 4.18 all the way down to the bump spot. Cruz Pedregon with a 5.68 in the Toyota.
Pretty precarious bump spot because there are five cars not yet qualified. They have one session to do so. Coming up, the K&N Horsepower Challenge. Here are the challenge competitors. Alan Johnson, who won the challenge in 2008. He will take on Shane Gray, making his challenge debut. Missing from Jason Lyne's resume is a challenge title. He will face Erica Enders in her second challenge start and her first since 2006. Greg Anderson is the defending champ here. Greg faces Ohio's Ron Critcher in his seventh challenge race. Mike Edwards, last year's challenge runner-up. And he will take on Roger Brogdon in his second consecutive challenge start. It's coming up next. This is a huge moment here at Norwalk at the Summit Racing Equipment Nationals. It's the K&N Horsepower Challenge. Introductions are underway. Jason Line being introduced. He has never won the challenge. In just a few moments, he will face Erica Enders. He's the number one. Here's the way they run the K&N Horsepower Challenge. The drivers accumulate points. They started at this race last year all the way up to Bristol a week ago.
They took the top 7 points earners for position for a spot in the K&N Horsepower Challenge, and the 8th and final position was voted online, and that ended up going to Erica Enders. Now, they got a $76,000 purse with $50,000 going to the winner, Paul.
Yeah, and if you win the race on Sunday as well, you get another $50,000, and then you are rich. And Bob, right now, you're the best friend of Mike Dunn and Paul Payne. You can win that thing that way. This was earlier. I want Roger Brogdon. Remember, the K&N is part of qualifying. And Roger Brogdon currently sits as the number one qualifier right now. That could change in the running of this first round of the K&N Challenge. Here's the way they'll pair up.
And when you look at that ladder, Roger Brogdon is going to have Mike Edwards in that first round matchup. Mike Edwards is going to have the lane choice, but he's also going to be trying to just get in the field. Also, Alan Johnson and Shane Gray, Greg Anderson and Ron Krischer. And as you mentioned, Jason Line will have lane choice over Erica Enders.
Well, the first pair is ready to go. Ron Krischer over there on the far side and Greg Anderson. Some of the most sophisticated cars in the world. They can do so many adjustments with timers on these cars, including on the shock absorbers. For Greg, his 9th K&N Horsepower Challenge. Last year, he used 2 hole shots to win the final round over Mike Edwards. Now he faces Ron Krischer, who, being from right here in Ohio, not all that far away, thinks this is a very big deal. He would love to come home with the win, and he runs power for Mike Edwards.
As far as Greg Anderson goes, his one pass, the chassis and engine very, very close. They know exactly where to go to make the car better. For Ron Krischer, he now has the help of a former world champion of this class, Jim Yates, helping him out. They said they were too aggressive in the middle during their first pass, so they're going to gear it a little closer to zero, try to get the motor and the rear end a little closer together, and they think that may be enough.
Well, based on the times they ran that first session, they were within 1/1000th of a second. A 660 with a 2 for Greg Anderson, a 660 with a 3 for Ron Krischer. Now, we talk about pressure here. It's a Summit race for Greg Anderson, the sponsors race. Usually it's added pressure, but both him and Jason seem to thrive on it. Seem like they always do very well at their sponsors races for the most part.
Did you see his eyes a moment ago? He's ready.
Focused.
Goodbye to Ron Krischer right off. Let's see what Greg is capable of pulling down. It's a 660 at 209 miles an hour.
Neither driver had great reaction to go on board with Greg Anderson, but right away, Ron Krischer had problems. Probably spun the tires way too hard when he let the clutch out. Greg Anderson almost matched his qualifying time, and it was good enough to move him to the next round.
Well, closest to you, that is Mike Edwards. Now, remember, the challenge is part of qualifying. Mike Edwards is not yet in the field. The bump is held by Steve Speed, a 663 with a 9. Mike Edwards and Roger Brogdon.
And remember, Mike Edwards has lane choice because it's based on your points position coming into this race. Mike Edwards is your number 3 points getter in the K&N Challenge. Roger is your number 6. Even though Roger Brogdon made that great pass in the first session, he's the quickest car on the premises. Mike gets his choice of lane.
Mike, I just talked to Terry Adams, one of the crew chiefs on this effort, and they said they flat missed it in that first qualifying pass. He said they were spinning tires down the racetrack. I said, so what kind of changes do you make on a scale of 1 to 10? He says, it's pretty big. It's about a 6. We're changing the four link. We're changing the shocks. We're taking the gear ratio. Amazing. Mike Edwards has never won this event, and once again, he may be susceptible right here.
That's a lot of changes to make to come up there. But, I mean, obviously they were way off to not be able to get down the track in that first session.
You really only like to change just one thing and make it work. That is taking an enormous chance. But
Terry Adams, he's as good as anybody out there, and he just feels he did not have a baseline. He's got to go back and try to find the baseline. He felt he had to make that number of changes just to get there. He knows he has the horsepower to do it, but he also knows he's got to make a good run against that man right there. Roger Brogdon's, you see Terry adjusting the wheelie bars because Roger made a fantastic run. He's been running very well all year long. So this is a good matchup if Mike Edwards can get that thing hooked up and make a good run.
And with Roger, you're talking Victor Cagnazzi power. So two big power plants here. Edwards left.
What happened, Rod? That looked like he had no clutch.
Wow, you heard the radio call from Roger Brogdon. He said it felt like it didn't have any clutch. So basically it was slipping the clutch. Oh, look at the side shot from Roger Brogdon. This is cool. Oh, listen, you can hear the engine. You can hardly hear it pull down during the shifts. I think he's absolutely right. It was just out there slipping the clutch. And when that happens, it's just not pulling the car down the racetrack. And Mike Edwards gets the win.
Well, back in Robert Heights' pit, they're working away. Getting that blower all taken apart.
Taking the rotors out of that supercharger. They'll check all that. Cylinder head guys there checking all the nozzles, making sure that they're all right before they put them on that car and get ready to come back for that next session.
In the meantime, out on the starting line as part of the K&N Horsepower Challenge, here is Shane Gray and Alan Johnson. For Shane, he's a rookie to this. This is his first start. And for that man, Alan Johnson, he won it in 2008, and he did that on a hole shot over Greg Anderson. Had a perfect life to win the race.
You heard in his interview talking about how you got to really be ready on that Christmas tree to get that good reaction time. But Alan's had a very good car all year. He's in that right-hand lane. We just saw Mike Edwards not in the show, and then Terry Adams makes the call, goes to the number one spot with that fantastic 6:59 run. So we know the right lane's there. I don't think there's anything wrong with the left because in the previous session we saw a lot of good runs. It's one of those things that hurt Roger Brogdon slipping the clutch too much. Oh, Alan sideways.
Oh, and Alan is out of it. Shane Gray is going to move on. Yeah, Johnny Gray, his dad, who races now in Funny Car, pretty happy you saw the smile. 6:62, 208 miles an hour. What happened to this guy?
Well, if you told me before this run that both drivers are going to leave pretty much even and Shane Gray was going to run a 6:62, I would have said that's probably not going to be enough. But obviously, Alan Johnson had trouble when he left the clutch. It just spun the tires, made a right-hand turn. All he could do was lift off the throttle and push in the clutch.
And, Mike, of most significance for Shane Gray was the fact that he got in. He got past round one as a rookie, and he did so with his own power plant. That is a Gray Motorsports power plant. He takes a lot of pride in being able to do that at this specialty race.
Well, here comes Jason Lyne and Erica Enders, number one and number eight. Jason Lyne by points. Erica Enders was voted in. Let's go to the top end and Gary.
Dave Reif was telling us with a conversation with Terry Adams that you had to make a lot of changes before that run. How apprehensive does that make it for you then as the driver?
Yeah, we're real apprehensive. We didn't really know what to expect that time, Gary. We were definitely behind the eight ball trying to win a round and try to qualify. This is our last shot to qualify for this race tomorrow. So a lot of pressure. This old man, I don't know how much longer he can take all this.
He's smiling. He's grinning. He's going to the second round. And there's a $50,000 carrot out there.
Well, watching Erica right now, sister Courtney and his dad Greg.
Yeah, you know, it looks good.
Looks good. Right place.
Sure, that thing's pointed straight down that racetrack, and two very good cars on the line right now. Coming into this final session, they were number two and three qualifier before Mike Edwards run, so they're running very close together. Two cars that make comparable horsepower, and Erica's been making some very good runs lately. Obviously, Jason with the lane choice. Everybody with lane choice thus far is taking that right-hand lane. Good race.
Erica takes down Jason Lyne. a 6.58, 209 miles an hour, and Erica Enders is going to move on. She will face Greg Anderson.
What a drag
That's
race.
That's good. Dave Reed.
And a little cherry on top of that ice cream. You're now the number one qualifier heading into tomorrow's race. Being as your daughter, Greg, got the fan vote. She goes out here right now. What does that mean as far as pride for you?
It's inexplicable as a father to stand here and watch her daughter do something. It's the only thing she does that's safer than letting her go on a date. And when she whips up on the boys, I tell everybody, 20 years and 20 million, I couldn't be more excited.
Way to go, Pops. Let's go down to the far end and catch up with Gary Gerald.
Standing by with Shane Gray, who just watched that eye-popping run by Erica Enders against Jason Lyne. Your thoughts as you get ready now for the second round, because as it turns out, you and your car had the slowest of the four elapsed times that advance.
Well, yeah, we need to step it up. We definitely need to step up the Service Central NTB car for this next round, but we're going to go back and look at the data and see what we can do to help the thing and just go out and do our best. And I just want to thank K&N for putting this race on. It's a lot of fun.
We'll see you in a bit.
All right, thank you.
Let's go back and take a look at that last run for that lady, Erica Enders.
Well, how about Jason Lyon on the right side of your screen? He makes what would have been the quickest run of the session, that 6.58.9, but unfortunately, Erica Enders makes the best run, low ET, and gets the win.
I think this may be her year. And here is the matchup for the semifinals. The lane choice will go to Erica when she faces Greg Anderson.
Now the matchup, Mike Edwards is going to have lane choice with that 6.59 elapsed time over Shane Gray.
So you can win $50,000 for the challenge. You can win $25,000 if you win the race itself and add a $25,000 double up bonus for the challenge. You got 100 grand. Greg did it last year. First, he got the challenge, got the check, $50,000, and the trophy for the K&N Horsepower Challenge. And then in the race itself against Alan Johnson, bingo, another win light, and bam-o, 100K into his account.
Berlin's legendary Olympic Stadium is quiet now, but tomorrow a sold-out crowd will be watching two-time defending World Cup champion Germany take on Canada in the opening round of FIFA World Cup 2011, live on ESPN.
Uphill battle there for Canada. Back in the staging lanes at Norwalk, Ohio. The Summit Racing Equipment Nationals, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. And I'm Paul Page. Mike Dunn's alongside me. Gary Gerald, Dave Reif, they're all covering this event. And standing there in the staging lanes is Andrew Hines. He has not yet made it into this field, and he only has one more chance to do it. Let's go out to the starting line. Pro Stock Cars. This is Mark Hogan and Johnny Gaydosh. Both trying to make it into this field. Whoa! Gaydosh is in trouble. Slams the wall. He's going to catch it again as it comes across the track. Big, big crash for Johnny Gaydosh. By the way, in a preseason test, he also crashed this car, rebuilt it himself. He's moving in the cockpit, so apparently he's okay. Huge crash, though.
What a shame for John Gaydosh. As you mentioned, he crashed in preseason tests and rebuilt this car himself. But you watch it. It moves over towards the center, starts shaking the tires. He gets out of it at that point. But, boy, the thing just throttle snaps around. Basically, the rear tires just kind of hooked, pushed him into that right side retaining wall, spun him all the way around, and then spun once more. And it got up on two wheels pretty high. I thought at one point right about here it was possibly going to go over. Then the wall straightened it out a little bit. Bumps into that left side wall, but luckily, John Gaydosh is A-OK.
And here is one more look at it.
As soon as he launched, the car went towards the center, and then it just started getting loose. And when he got out of it, it just came right around on him and just started spinning. And like I said, right there, she was up on two wheels and then came to a stop on that left side retaining wall. And boy, is he mad. He just wrecked that car he just fixed.
Gary is with him.
Well, fortunately, John Gadosh says he is all right. What an adventure. And it's the second time that this has happened to you here this season. Take us through this one, John.
I left the starting line. It felt good. Went through second, third gear. Got in third gear. Started shaking. I lifted. As soon as I lifted, it started getting out of the groove. Went towards the wall and all of a sudden started spinning and shaking. Nothing I could do about it and just kept on going. On the brakes, tried to pull the chutes. Didn't matter.
This has got to be so tough because, as I understand, I think you took out a second mortgage earlier this year trying to make it possible to come out here and go racing. How big of a setback may this be?
This is a huge setback. This is probably the worst thing that probably ever could happen to me again this year. This is, I don't know, just speechless. Don't have words for it, but see what we can do. Get back in and try it again.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Have a great day.
Johnny Gadosh, obviously okay. Let's take a look at Pro Stock Motorcycle, the first session.
Take a look at Jim Underdahl on the left, Hector Rana Jr. on the right. Watch Hector. Jim Underdahl has palms right off the start, but look at Hector run down the racetrack. Great 688 elapsed time at 191 miles per hour.
Track record for Junior. His dad loves it. Career best. And now, we are in the final session of Pro Stock Motorcycle. That man right there, Andrew Hines, former champion, not qualified. He'll go side by side with Bailey Whitaker. The bump is GT Tonglet, a 7-11. They've done a lot of testing with this bike that still confuses them, but it was at least good enough to get him a 6.97. He moves up into seventh position and into the top half of the field. Andrew Hines is in. The standings in Pro Stock Motorcycle go this way. Junior, Hector Arana Jr., he is now number one. Jerry Savoie continues to do well, sits second. Angie Smith is at the bottom of the top eight.
We take a look at the bottom eight. You see our defending Full Throttle champion, Ellie Tomlin, on the bump spot with a 7.098 on the Suzuki.
And those who have not yet made it into this field, including GT Tonglet, who just got pushed out. But look down there. Hector Arana. Yeah, the dad's not in. Well, his kid's on the pole. And here he is. Here's Hector on the line. That's Joe DeSantis over across the way. Hector on his Buell is the quickest rider ever. Now, is he going to make it in?
Hector's 105 and 60 foot. That's pretty good.
That'd give you an impression.
We know he has the power.
6.95 with a 6. That's good enough to get him up to 7th place. He's in the top half of the field. It does push Andrew Hines down to 8. DeSantis doesn't make it in. At the line, they call her Red Dawn. Dawn Minturn on the Suzuki and GT Tonglet. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Well, Erica Enders, that fan vote puts you in this field. You've taken full advantage. When you knock off the number one seed, how good does that feel?
Oh, it feels awesome. You know, Jason and the Summit boys are very tough customers. We knew that going in, and we had to lay down a good run. We made a nice pass first qualifying session, but for this Alza Energy Chevy Cobalt, my entire team to go out there and make a solid run like that, and I'm just so proud of my guys. Can't thank the fans enough. Thank you, guys. We're going to do our best to go win this deal.
Can't rest on your laurels. Got to be focused and ready for round two.
Always focused. Thanks, guys.
Both these two are trying to make it in. GT Tonglet runs a 7.07. That puts him on 16th. Red Dawn doesn't get in. Let's go to Dave Reif.
Robert, earlier when you were talking to Gary Gerald, we heard the apprehension in your voice about two sessions of qualifying. Well, now you have a 4.06 tucked in your back pocket. What are the feelings now?
We can definitely breathe a sigh of relief. You know, we're in good. And, you know, Jimmy Prock being the ultimate perfectionist, he picks that run apart. He says, we can do better here. We can do better there. It slipped a little early. So if we fix all that, I believe we can run a little quicker. But if we mess up, we definitely have a little insurance with that 06 run. It's going to stay in the top four. And I'll be able to sleep good tonight.
Smiling big.
Well, this is kind of interesting. Here is Ellie Tonglet, who won the championship in his rookie years, up on the line, his Nitro Fish bike. He is trying to get into the field. The bump is GT Tonglet, a 7.07 with a 7.
Who just bumped Ellie out.
Exactly.
The brothers are battling.
Ellie lays down a 7-12. You know what?
There's a surprise.
That's not happening. Ellie Tonglet will not race on Sunday. His brother, GT, will. Well, when we come back, we're going to be talking the K&N Horsepower Challenge again. It was Jason Lyne and Erica Enders in the first round, and Erica ended up with the win. Now she turns around to face Jason's teammate, Greg Anderson. That's when the K&N Challenge comes back to the line. $50,000 is on that line. The great traditions when you come to Norwalk, Ohio at the Summit Motorsports Park is ice cream. They serve gallons, hundreds of gallons, thousands of gallons of ice cream. It's part of the summer tradition here in Ohio. And you know why? That's 1 pound of ice cream for a dollar. That's the kind of number you can live with, right, Mike?
You're still a dollar? I mean, come on.
Dollar.
How many gallons do you get?
Eddie Krawick, David Hope. Field is set, trying to improve on position. Hope does. He goes from 10th up to 8th. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Ellie Tonglet, first time in your career to have the disappointment of not making a field. How tough is it on a day when you only got two chances and the rain set you back?
It's tough. You know, we needed all four of those runs to break this new motor in, and unfortunately the rain came all day yesterday and we just didn't have enough runs to get after this new motor, and hopefully we'll go testing at home and make some runs on it for Chicago.
Now he has to cheer on his brother who just made it into the field in the bump spot as we check in with Stat Guy.
Let's talk about Gary Stouffer, the crew chief for Karen. He actually went to Sweden a couple weeks ago. He helped out Frederick Fredlund, who actually raced at Gainesville on the Kate Sullivan bike early this year. They set the national record in kilometers, 306, which translates to about 190 miles per hour. He bought a motor, carbon clutch. They had a great time over there.
Now here's Karen Stouffer and Anzi Smith. While Karen Suzuki is flying, Anzi is on a Buell. And there is low of the round, a 6.93 for Karen Stouffer. Isn't going to change her position. She will stay in fourth, and Anzi will stay 10th. And already they're getting set for the semifinal, the K&N Horsepower Challenge. Erica Enders, she is going to face Greg Anderson. Could she be on her way to a win here? Back on the line, Pro Stock Motorcycle, Matt Smith and Chip Ellis. Matt Smith, who lost his sponsor in the last couple of weeks, was third. That's where he's going to stay. And Chip Ellis, well, he's going to stay in sixth. That will bring up our last pair in Pro Stock Motorcycle, and this is the end of their last session. Hector Arana, currently number one, Arana Jr., and Jerry Savoie. So if Savoie is looking to take number one, this would have been where he would do it. Jerry Savoie is going to stay number two. Arana Jr. has his first number one. Wow, the rookie is looking so good. He ran a career best in session one, and in doing so ran a track record, a 6.88 with a 7. So here is the Lucas Oil Pro Stock Motorcycle Ladder. Well, Hector's going to take on GT Tonglet with that tricky new bike. And David Hope has Andrew Hines. That'll be a great matchup.
Let's take a look at the other side. Jerry Savoie is going to go up against Steve Johnson, with Jerry having that lane choice. And then Hector Arana Sr., he's going to have lane choice over Andy Smith.
Let's go to Gary Gerald.
As the helmet comes off, Hector Arana Jr., that smile says an awful lot. For the first time in your very short career, you're a number one qualifier. What's that feel like?
Man, it's the greatest feeling in the world, but it wouldn't be possible without Forrest Lucas and Charlotte and the whole Lucas Oil family and my brother and my father. It's just it's a great honor to be racing for them, and I thank them a lot. And Larry Morgan and Dave at the shop, they've been helping me. We worked on this chassis and this engine, and it shows. We're doing number one.
Absolutely. Only the second father-son combo to be number one qualifiers, following a standard set by the Hines clan in years gone by. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And he attends Purdue University, right in my own state. The K&N Horsepower Challenge. This is the semifinals. It's Shane Gray and Mike Edwards. And we'll take a look at the ladder for you. Erica Enders shortly will face Greg Anderson. Shane Gray right now will take on Mike Edwards. Let's go to Dave Reed.
It says on Greg Anderson's dash, success comes from cans, failures come from can'ts. What can you do right now with Eric Anderson?
Hopefully I can beat her. We'll see. We've had a little tire shake today, so we need to clear that up, and I think we have a good shot. She's been really hot lately, doing a great job, and my work's cut out for me. I don't have lane choice, but we'll see what we can do, David.
Well, you look at Mike Edwards, runner-up last year, his fourth challenge final, if he can get into it. But looking to race in the final round in the challenge, Shane Gray, his rookie debut. Last driver to win the challenge in their first start was Jed Coughlin, 1999.
Oh, Shane, red light.
For Shane.
By one thousandth of a second. Wow.
Johnny Gray, his dad, who used to race pro stock, now back in funny car. The win goes over to Mike Edwards. 662, 208 mile an hour pass.
Well, Shane knew he had to take a shot because Mike Edwards ran so well in the previous round, but he's going to be kicking himself because he missed it by one thousandth of a second. If he would have just stayed just slightly different, that could have been the difference between winning, and he actually made it a better run on the racetrack than Mike Edwards. But unfortunately for Shane, Mike Edwards is going to the final.
Yeah, and that's one of those moments that a driver will think about for years. Here's our other pair in the semifinal. There is Erica Enders, and she goes up against the very powerful Greg Anderson. But Erica's looking pretty good. It's her first challenge final, if she can make it. She's still looking for her first ever Wally. That guy, Greg Anderson, fourth consecutive challenge final, and he is the defending champion. You heard him talk about a little bit of tire shake they got to clear up. And obviously in the interview, you heard he has great respect for Erica.
Paul and Mike, I talked to the Zaza Energy crew. They were very impressed with their run, but when they looked at it on computer, they said they had a little bit left. However, they are running so good, they were a little too scared to make a lot of changes. They're going to make Greg Anderson beat them, the same exact setup they had in round one.
Well, the one thing they changed that they didn't want to make is they stayed in the left-hand lane. They're the first pro stock car that's done so in the K&N Challenge. We heard Greg Anderson talk about not having lane choice, but I don't think he's going to be complaining about having that right-hand lane. But Eric Anderson, I got to believe that Dave Conley and that team, that's a good call. I mean, let's face it, they ran low ET of the meet in that left-hand lane, so there's obviously nothing wrong with it. The setup's right.
Enders and Greg Anderson. Greg Anderson, a double 08 light.
Wow.
And a win. 658, 209 miles an hour. That's one very determined man. Greg Anderson goes into the final.
What a great pass by that Summit car. As you go on board, 008 had the advantage by almost 300ths of a second off of that starting line, and then runs a great 658 with a 3 at 209 miles per hour when pretty much everybody else has been struggling getting down both lanes.
And with Mike Edwards, we check in with him. You're going one step away from a $50,000 payday, but from a performance standpoint, have you got enough muscle to take care of this guy Anderson, the defending champ?
I think we do right now, Gary. We better go back and see what we can do and see if we can pick up a little bit. But, we're in the finals again. He was here last year against Greg, and he whooped me. So, I don't know. Maybe it's my turn. Honestly, we'll see.
All right. Let's check in with Statman.
Of course, it'll be a rematch of last year's final round. Mike Edwards and Greg Anderson. Greg Anderson with lane choice. But here's the stat. The last time we had the same finalists in back-to-back finals, you have to go back to 1989 and 1990 when Larry Morgan faced off against Warren Johnson. Been a long time.
Well, that's the setup then for the K&N Horsepower Challenge. And we've been talking about tension, pressure. This is Erica's father on the line. Yeah. Pretty tough to take. More qualifying and the finals for the K&N Challenge still to come. Happy Greg Anderson. He has made it to the finals of the K&N Horsepower Challenge. His wife, Kim, is pretty happy, too. Let's go to Gary.
Greg Anderson, you're knocking on the door of being a repeat four-time champion now in this K&N Horsepower Challenge. You started the day saying you were extremely confident. How is that confidence playing out for you?
That's what K&N does for me. I love K&N. I love Summit Racing Equipment. Here we are, Summit Motorsports Park. Can't get any better for me, you know, and we had all that great karma and great luck last year. It's kind of shaving up the same. I can't believe it. Guys did a fantastic job on the card. I didn't quite have the horse first two rounds, but obviously they fixed us. And now I got a horse, and we'll go give Mike a battle. So 50K, man. 50 grand on the line, and see what we can do.
I look forward to it. Thanks.
Right. Thanks.
50K coming up shortly. We'll see who gets it. Well, they've ruled the Dakin's run was good. We have now a field set, but you can still improve your position. Here's Bob Vandergrift and Luigi Novelli. I like it. Oh, Luigi! I'm just complimenting him, trying to build it up big. 394 with a 5 for Bob Vandergrift. That moves him up, doesn't get him into the top half, though he's 9th.
And Luigi, I don't know what happened. As soon as he hit the throttle, the thing just quit. Possibly could have, boy, look at that thing bucking and bouncing. Wow, that was a wild ride. But Bob Vandergrift made a decent run to move up. Didn't move up in the top half, but see that thing just went up on the wheelie bar. I don't know what happened there. That was a mess.
Well, coverage is now underway for ESPN's coverage of the FIFA Women's World Cup. Germany 2011, Nigeria and France at 8:45 in the morning, and then Germany and Canada on at 11:30 in the morning. Antoine Brown, Ike Meyer. Meyer trying to get into his second race. He last raced at Atlanta. Antoine was in the final round at Bristol. Ended up as the runner-up. Hey, you see the remnants of some blocks going down the track. Antron's posted a 390. It's a 411 for Meyer.
Antoine Brown struggled to get down the track in the first session. The track's much warmer right now, so they want to definitely just get down the track. Now watch, cylinders went out just before the finish line, slowed them down considerably at 390 at only 287 miles per hour.
And let's take a look here and see what happened to the foam block. Watch the right side of your screen. That's Meyer.
Well, he made a left turn when the cylinders went out just past the eighth mile and then took out the finish line blocks.
And back in the pit area, this is Matt Hagen's pit. He is currently standing fourth in Funny Car. They're warming it up. Like to come away with a number one before this day is over. The question is whether or not they can get that done. Spencer Massey, Larry Dixon on the line. Dixon, of course, our most recent winner. He's at 12th right now. Yeah, I wouldn't say so. 387 for him. Massey's a 389, so Larry Dixon gets up into the top half of the field, but that is his lowest start of this year.
Take another look at both cars were on pretty good runs to about the finish line. Then they had some cylinders coming out. And watch the right side of your screen. You're going to see Spencer Massey. He's going to lose the blower belt as the cylinder goes out right there. It looked like it was spinning the tires. And then right after he lifts, the belt comes flying off of it.
Well, we saw the belt fly off of Spencer Massey's car. Here's the belt on Larry Dixon's machine. It is still fully intact. It started to shred just a little bit. Dixon said that it popped when he backed off the throttle. Didn't impact a nice 387 pass.
That's kind of unique. Two different situations. One blower belt breaks. The other one just shears all the teeth and falls off.
Isn't that a beautiful shot? Aerial coverage is provided by Goodyear. Everything we've learned making tires for the proving grounds of the NHRA inspires what we roll into yours. Goodyear, more driven. Top fuel action continues. Sunshine is out now. It's a lot different than it was when we were totally rained out on Friday. And it's Sean Langdon and David Grubnick on the line. If he can stay there, which means fourth, Sean Langdon will have his best start of the year. David Grubnick has lost in first round the last four races in a row. didn't like those tires. Grubnik 396, Langdon 490, and neither one changes their position.
And Paul, as a byproduct of that earlier run by Spencer Massey, saw the belt go away. It took out a support bar, and look closely, that's a hole in the belly pan. That's asphalt you see underneath.
Wow. Hey, Greg Anderson. Is he going to win the $50,000 in the K&N Challenge? It would be his fourth time to do it. But he's got to get around last year's runner-up, Mike Edwards. Fast, powerful car. We'll be back. The NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. We are in Norwalk, Ohio for the Summit Racing Equipment Nationals. Top Fuel, Brandon Bernstein and Terry McMillan. There's Terry. And one of his, really a teammate and a crewmate, ran Top Fuel last week. A nice thing for him. Austin Lambright. Brandon Bernstein, pole sitter last week, runs a 389. It's a 423 for McMillan, and they stay where they were. Bernstein is third, McMillan is 10th.
If you go on board with Terry, you're going to see they're pretty much side by side for 300 feet, and then Terry spins the tires at that point, gets off of the throttle. Brandon Bernstein makes a nice run, that 389. Didn't improve on the 385, but in the heat, I think they'll be okay with that.
Here's one of the big stories in Funny Car when they come up for their second and final session of qualifying, Melanie Troxell. She's not yet in this field. But don't forget our coverage of the final eliminations here. ESPN2, 8 o'clock. There's also coverage on ESPN3.com. He owns the car that Melanie Troxell drives and some Pro Mod cars. That's Leah Pruitt-LeDuc, who has been testing in a Funny Car for him as well. Big mogul in the port. Doug Coletta, Tony Schumacher are up now. Coletta currently sits in eighth. Schumacher in second. Can Schumacher take number one away from Dale Worsham? No, not even close. Schumacher is going to remain second. Coletta will remain in eighth.
Well, with Larry Dixon and Morgan Lucas on the racetrack, they're the last Top Fuel pair before we hand out $50,000 to either that man, Greg Anderson, or Mike Edwards. And this is the man who works on the horsepower underneath the Summit car. We heard Greg talking about earlier not having the kind of horse he needed. What's his horsepower going to be like here for this final?
Well, based on the last run, it should be very good. Not just one of the guys that does it. We got a great group of guys back at the shop. But our Summit car is finally coming around, so I feel like we got a really good shot to win this thing.
Keep in mind, this guy knows a lot about horsepower. He worked with Joe Gibbs Racing back in the NASCAR days and now creates a lot of it for Greg Anderson and that entire KB team.
Our final pair, Top Fuel, Dale Worsham, currently number one, and Morgan Lucas, who sits fifth right now. The Pomona winner, of course, Morgan Lucas, and Dale. Wow, he's just been so hard to beat this year.
That 379, that's going to hold up because basically what we're seeing with this session with the sun out on that new asphalt being a little bit green, they're getting more wheel spin down on the other end. We're seeing some tire smoke. We're seeing the top end speeds are down about 10 miles an hour from the previous session or more. So obviously they're having to adjust for that, but probably what they're going to be seeing for race day tomorrow.
Issues 468 for Worsham, 494 for Morgan Lucas. Everything stays the way it is. The Top Fuel qualifying is completed, and here is the Lucas Oil Ladder. Doug Coletta will have Antron Brown for Morgan Lucas and Sean Langdon together as the best start of the season for the team.
Other side of the ladder, Spencer Massey is going to go up against Terry McMillan. He's been running much more consistent lately, and Larry Dixon is going to have lane choice over Bob Vandegrift in that matchup.
Dale Worsham pulls the helmet off, number one qualifier for the third time this season. How confident are you now going into eliminations tomorrow? Because it seems like every time you've been number one qualifier, you've made it at least to the finals.
Yeah. Feels good, you know.
got three in 1 year, and I think I have like, I had six, five my whole life before that. So, no, another great job for Alan Johnson and Brian, entire Alan Nobby Racing team. You know, when you have 1 day of qualifying, you know, you just want to just get qualified, much less be number one. So very lucky to be number one. Very glad for Alan Nobby, Toyota, Redline, everybody. All of our sponsors, they stayed stuck. That 379 was a great run, and I feel pretty good about my chances tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.
Dale Worsham, number one qualifier. Coming up next, Mike Edwards, Greg Anderson, $50,000 on the line. It's the K&N Horsepower Challenge. Back in the staging lanes here at Norwalk, Jeff Arend gets ready. He'd be coming up shortly because it will be Funny Car's final qualifying, and he's not in the field. Neither is Melanie Troxell. In fact, there are 21 Funny Cars here looking for the 16 positions. But it's the K&N Challenge up now. Determined look of Greg Anderson as he's ready to face Mike Edwards, and we'll show you the ladder that brought everybody to this time, this place, and the $50,000. All the way right down, Greg Anderson will have lane choice as they come up here in the final. Dave Reed.
Anderson going for his fourth, Mike Edwards going for his first, does so with a new engine underneath the hood as we got two great drivers at the starting line, two very excited fans down at the far end. They're part of the random drawing here. It's the K&N Horsepower Challenge. They voted and they got picked. If Mike Edwards happens to win this $50,000 win race, then Sharice James of Baltimore, Maryland will win a 2011 Ford Explorer courtesy of Ford and K&N. If Greg Anderson wins, it's Harold Goldberg from Rio Rancho, New Mexico. So much on the line here in this very exciting final.
Boy, they both traveled to win that Ford Explorer, didn't they?
Well, they want to be able to drive it back home, get used to it.
Oh, boy, that would be great. I'm tell you what, right now, though, it's a very, very good matchup. Greg Anderson, I got to give a slight advantage because he does have the lane choice, although we saw Erica make a very good run in that left-hand lane. And Greg Anderson, it seems like when that Summit team kind of get in that groove, and that great pass that they made in the semifinals, and Greg nailed the reaction time, they kind of keep it going. But Mike Edwards in the other lane, Terry Adams and the crew, I mean, they know how to make a ton of horsepower, and if they hit it right, can't count them out.
Here we go. They're pre-stage. $50,000 is a quarter mile away.
Through the last 3 years, it's been decided on a hole shot. Oh, big advantage for Mike Edwards.
Well, if it's going to be on a hole shot, Edwards would be there, but no.
Oh, he drives around.
658. 209 miles an hour. Greg Anderson drives around Mike Edwards, takes the win, takes the $50,000. And I think Kim Anderson may be the happiest because I'm thinking she's going to figure out how to spend it.
I'm bored with Greg. Mike Edwards, 013 lights and 040 advantage off the starting line. I thought it was going to be enough, but obviously the car must have probably spun a little bit or slipped the clutch out of Mike Edwards. And look at Greg Anderson pumping his fist because he made a great pass to get the win.
Now, take a look at Harold there on the right. Harold Goldberg, and he doesn't know. He doesn't know. Now he knows! Yeah! I'm driving home! Look at this. This is the photo finish cam, Mike.
Less than 200ths of a second, or just about a nose. Greg Anderson gets the check.
Oh, that's what Pro Stock and the K&N Horsepower Challenge is all about. You see it there. Mike Edwards left first. He was fine until 330 feet, and then Greg started taking over. Dave.
Rob Downing, we talked all day long about how focused Greg Anderson was, but I got to ask you about your team. They seem to have got up and risen to the occasion here today.
Well, yeah, to win this deal 2 years in a row is great. Yes, the team did a great job today to do it at the Summit sponsored race. I can't say enough about everybody. And I'd like to say thanks to K&N, thanks to Summit, thanks to all the guys.
A little surprise from everybody. Greg Anderson and this entire KB team, incredible today.
Yeah, you need to be celebrating.
Yeah!
Oh, that's wonderful to see. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Man, you can get hurt from the high fives here at the top end. A special ring, a special trophy. Harold Goldberg is elated. He's going to drive off in that new Explorer. Greg Anderson, for the fourth time, you savor this moment. Do they just get better and better?
Yes, they do. It just is unbelievable. K&N, thank you so much. Summit Racing Equipment, here we are, man. I love this place. I love you guys. For all you do for Pro Stock, it's so wonderful to be able to race for this cash. All year long, you support the class. Really the best supporter I think the class has got. So thank you so much. Ken, buddy, this one's for you. Thank you for supporting us. I know we've been a little off, buddy, but maybe this is going to jumpstart our season just like last year. So thank you so much. Love you, man. Thank everybody on this race car, man, from Trick Flow to Findlay Chevrolet to Wilson Manifold to Racer's Edge and the Carhartt people this weekend. Just a fantastic weekend so far. Redline Oil. Thank you all so much. K&N, you are the best. Yes.
Well, let's get a word over here with Harold Goldberg. Harold, this vehicle behind you is going to be yours. You driving that back to New Mexico?
No, I think I'll probably pick it up there.
Tell us what the emotion of this day has been like for you.
Oh, it's just been unbelievable. I don't even know how to explain it.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
I know he's going to enjoy it.
Yeah!
Harold's into it. All right, here is the Lucas Oil Pro Stock Ladder for final eliminations on Sunday, 8 o'clock. Alan Johnson and Greg Anderson. So Anderson just off of this big win, but Alan Johnson's been making some horsepower.
Mike Edwards went to the final. He's going to run Ron Krischer in that first-round matchup. And local favorite Larry Morgan, he's going to have lane choice over V Gaines.
Well, we've got a little point and counterpoint for you from the elation of the big win and $50,000 to this car, Melanie Troxell, who is not yet in this field and very shortly will have her last chance. Well, Greg Anderson, a little special thank you for K&N, gives his new trophy a nice big smooch. Imagine he ought to be smooching that check as well. Funny car. Here is Melanie Troxell. She is not in of the 21 cars that came here and two qualifying sessions. Now, what does she need to do?
Yeah, it's tough anytime you have a rain-shortened event like this and you only get two sessions. I mean, it's up to the team to go up, and you really can't afford to make a mistake on that first pass because you need to get a decent run down the track, and we didn't do that in the first session. So, unfortunately, the Pro Mod's not in. But we've got one more session in the funny car, and I think the guys tell me that they're very confident that they've given us a good, solid, conservative tune-up that'll get down the track. So, you know, that's my job now as a driver, is to go up there with that confidence and do the best job I can.
She'll be focused.
Well, the key is going to be get the car down the racetrack. Right now, Cruz Petron's on the bump spot with a 568, but that doesn't really matter. I think really she's got to run about a 420 or quicker. Problem is, the sun's out. We saw the top fuel. The track on the other end, once you get on that asphalt transition, not quite as good, but still definitely good enough to run a mid-14 to a 420 lap time.
568 with an 8. You see it right there. Cruises the bump.
There you go.
Oh, yeah. 421. Melanie Troxell is in at 13. Cruz is out. So with Melanie in there, still room for other people. Here comes Dale Creasy Jr. and John Capps. Capps is not in. Creasy Jr. is the bump with a 557.
Remember, with 21 cars and a lot of good cars behind her not in the field, it's going to be interesting to see if that 421 will hold up.
For John Capps, he's in the field. Creasy is out. Terry Haddock now on the bump. Of 489 is the bump time.
And it does not get in.
All right, here's the scenario right now. Robert Height is number one, down through Pauly in the top eight. At the bottom half of the field is where things really begin to matter, because this can all change. Terry Haddock is on the bump with a 489, and look at this list, not in. Cruz Pedregon and Johnny Gray and Jeff Arend, all yet to come up. So here is Jeff Arend and Terry Haddock. Bump is 489. NASCAR 423 for Jeff Wren. He's in the field, though I don't think he's going to be all that happy with being in there at 14. I think they were hoping for more.
Terry Haddock, he caught this thing on fire pretty early. He saw the car was just really soft early. Probably had a cylinder out at some point, but we saw the fire light up and lost the burst panel. But take a look at it, just laboring down the racetrack and gets that a little bit out of the groove. There's a cylinder goes out. As soon as that cylinder went out, boy, it lit up big time, launched the burst panel out of that body, and obviously Terry had to get out of the throttle at that point.
And so back to the line, Brian Thiel and Daniel Wilkerson. Dan, of course, is son of Tim Wilkerson, trying to make his name in the sport now. And Theo, he's a rice farmer when not racing. He's got 4,000 acres. And he's trying to get in. Boy, the car's all over the place. Let's see what he comes up with. A 4.13.
Nice run.
And that is going to put him not just in the field, but in the top half of the field at sixth.
Very
it puts
nice run.
John Capps out and puts Thiel on the bump. Sunday night baseball, it continues at 8 o'clock. The Cleveland Indians are on their way to San Francisco for a matchup against the Giants. And then on Monday night baseball, 7 o'clock in the evening, the Cincinnati Reds take on the Tampa Bay Rays. Both games are part of the ALNL Showdown presented by State Farm. Well, here's Johnny Gray trying to get in, and Tony Pedregon, who's already in. Boom. 4:44 for Johnny Gray, and he does not make it into this field. Tony Pedregon does not improve his 11th either.
4:44.
And how about his brother, Cruz? Cruz is not yet in. He's going to go side-by-side with Tim Wilkerson. How about Danny, the young son of Tim, who has now out-qualified his dad? We'll see what his dad can do in a minute. It takes more than hope. ESPN presentation of the Summit Racing Equipment NHRA Nationals is brought to you by Full Throttle. Grab a Full Throttle energy drink and feel the energy at work. Summit Racing Equipment, the world's speed shop, and Visa. More people go with Visa. A look across the Ohio countryside, up toward the lake, that is Cedar Point, the world-famous amusement park, including the Top Fuel roller coaster there. Cruz Pedregon, last time he didn't make it into a field was last year at Chicago. He and Tim Wilkerson are side-by-side. Cruz is trying to get in. Brian Thiel is the bump with a 4:25.
This is the final run to determine the 16 cars they'll be racing tomorrow. It's either going to be Cruz in and Thiel out, or Thiel be in and Cruz will be out.
Cruz, 4:15 with a 3. That moves him to the top half of the field.
Nice. Tim.
Well, you heard Cruz on the radio said he shut off down track, and got to believe he only went 287 miles per hour, but he was marching pretty good numbers early in that 4:15 elapsed time. As you said, moves him in that number 8 spot. Nice job by the Snap-on car.
Yeah, but Tim Wilkerson has been out-qualified by his son, Daniel. Here's Jim Head and Mike Neff.
It's a little close to the wall there.
Mike Neff, a 4:13, 4:32 for Head. They stay where they were. Well, something happened here, Mike.
Let's take a look. Right side of your screen, Mike Neff's car. Watch when it gets to the finish line. It's going to make a move right there. And look at the spill plate on the spoiler. It breaks off, and it looks like a piece goes over and lodges into the injector of Jim Head's car.
And the good news is, look at that, the injectors were closing when that piece got in there and jammed them.
Yeah, I believe Jim was already out of the throttle, which that could have been a disaster if he was still on the throttle. And there goes Jim talking to his buddy Zippy.
Well, Mike Neff drives a Ford Mustang, so too does Bob Task, of being treated to some Ford execs this weekend, including Elena Ford, Henry Ford's great-great-granddaughter. And she's just the tip of the spear, watching earlier today at the starting line where Henry Ford III, that's the man in the middle. Surrounding him, Mark Fields, the president of Ford America on the left, and Ken Zube, the group vice president on the right. Great to have these Ford execs on hand this weekend, watching their cars up close and personal.
This is the final pair in funny car. John Force, who has not yet won this year, despite being the defending the series champion. And Robert Hight, teammate, son-in-law. Robert Hight currently sits number one. John Force is number three. That guy.
Looks like Robert Height's going to take sole possession of fourth place in terms of number one starts. This would be number 39. Of course, John Force is the number one all-time leader.
All over the place. He runs a 4:20. It's a 4:13 for Height. Neither one improve on their session one qualifying time, and so they stay where they are, but it was low of the session. So let's take a look at the Lucas Oil ladder for final eliminations on the air at 8 o'clock on Sunday. Cruz Pedregon and Tim Wilkerson, both guys looking for a win this year. It's a good matchup. And Mike Neff and Tony Pedregon will be pretty good, too.
Other side of the ladder, that 4:21 for Melanie, held in for the number 15 spot. But she'll go up against Ron Capps, with Ron having the lane choice. And then how about John Force, who'll have lane choice over Jim Head.
But John Force, how much does it pain you as defending series champion that you haven't been able to get a Wally thus far this season?
Well, I'm glad the boys, you know, Robert Hyten at Ford and Mike Neff, doing their job. It's just, it's part of the game. It's the ups and downs. I got a good hot rod here. I'm not worried about that. It's just a matter of getting it organized, getting it balanced, making it go down the racetrack. We're learning every week. Yeah, it's a pain. It's a pain for Guido and Ron Douglas. But I tell you what, she came out, you know, she ran good early. You know, the number it ran earlier today, and only getting two runs, it's tough on the guy that doesn't get more than that. But the strong survive, and that's what we're trying to do.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
Well, it's been an interesting day with just two sessions of qualifying, and how about Greg Anderson, $50,000 richer. Can he double up when he goes to final eliminations? We'll have coverage at 8 o'clock tomorrow. And don't forget, coming up next, the Global Rallycross Championship to set the stage for X Games LA.